So, before we wrap up this PlayStation miniseries, I just have to say, I'm still thinking about Katamari Damacy a month later. It was just so nice to be able to play something so vibrant and joyous and free of violence. So what's the PS3 game I'm playing? Oh. Okay. Hooray? Or, wait, should it be... Oorah? This is Brand New Relic, the monthly series where I finally play the classic games I never got to try. Yes, if we're looking at the PS3, that means we're looking at first-person shooters, and there was none more iconic at the time than the 2007 title Call of Duty 4 Modern Warfare. So if you don't like spoilers, consider this your official alert, and also content warning for war, violence, and self-harm. After three games set in World War II, the folks at Infinity Ward decided to go in a different direction and present a game whose warfare was, you know, more modern. It changed the aesthetic of the franchise moving forward, and not a year has gone by without a new Call of Duty game hitting the market, including two Modern Warfare sequels, a remaster in 2016, and a kinda sorta reboot in 2019, along with warfares that aren't just modern, but also advanced, and infinite. It's all a little overwhelming, but we're just looking at this one title that changed it all. And by it all, I mean one gaming franchise. When I got my PlayStation 4, the very first game I played on it was Call of Duty Ghosts, which was, you know, fine, and which I've since donated. And I played some of the other games in the series, like Advanced Warfare, starring... Well, the less said about that, the better. I know that it's set in the Middle East, which was a very relevant setting given that President Bush was wrapping up his second term, and we were in both Iraq and Afghanistan at the time. As opposed to being in just Afghanistan. And I know that it has one of those moments you don't see coming involving a nuclear explosion. And that's about it. So let's answer the call of duty and try not to giggle whenever we hear the word duty.
"50,000 people used to live here. Now it's a ghost town."
Wait, we're in Chernobyl? I love that show. And already, I can tell that this game will not be nearly as funny as Katamari Damacy. And I normally don't want any sass, but I guess I'll have to make an exception.
"Good news first. The world's in great shape."
Oh, good to know. That was an easy game.
"We've got a civil war in Russia. Government loyalists against ultranationalist rebels. And 15,000 nukes at stake."
Oh, you were being sarcastic. You really are a member of sass.
"We've got a new guy joining us today. Fresh out of selection. His name's Soap."
My name is Soap? That's just temporary though, right? Like, I'll get my real nickname later? I play through a tutorial where everyone sounds like Jason Statham.
"You know the drill. Go to station one and aim your rifle downrange."
But I don't know the drill. And wait, I press L1 to aim and R1 to shoot? That's really gonna throw me off. You see these buttons here? That's L2 and R2. They're literally called triggers. But nope, we're using the shoulder buttons to aim and fire. But the auto aim is a nice feature.
"Knife the watermelon."
Wow, what did that watermelon ever do to me?
"Nice! Your fruit-killing skills are remarkable."
Why, thank you! And then I run through a drill, and based on my performance, they recommend my difficulty level, which is such a great idea, I'm genuinely surprised more games haven't used that device. You can even replay the drill to get a higher difficulty suggestion, which is probably not the best idea for me, but here we go! And then before I know it, we're boarding the Titanic.
"This is where we first met!"
Crew expendable? Just like Sylvester Stallone! The crew doesn't seem to notice a big old helicopter flying around, which just helps with their expendability. Ah, very funny. Okay, you don't need to come back for everything. Ah! Should have been common sense not to look directly at a flashbang grenade, but here we are. I'm already confused as to who's shooting at me and where they are, and every time I die, I get some pithy quote or fun fact about war. I can use these to absolutely dominate in Quizzo. We find a nuclear device with instructions written in Arabic, because of course they are. We get a hell of an explosion, which means it's time to leave the ship, and... not fast enough? That's what my PE teacher said in high school. And went the wrong way? That's what my guidance counselor said in high school. But I finally make it off the ship.
"Please, please, is it a big bird?"
And then we just suddenly switch protagonists.
"And now for something completely different."
Yes, now I'm playing the president of Saudi Arabia, who's just going for a nice Sunday drive. And then... well, that was an easy level. And then I'm back to being soap, and we play a night vision level, giving us Zero Dark Thirty vibes. Or Silence of the Lambs, based on your movie tastes. No, me first, everyone out of the way! And then because this game just can't decide on a protagonist, now I'm a Marine named Paul Jackson, playing a mission called Charlie Don't Surf. There's a terrorist broadcasting messages inside a television studio, so we... Sorry. I should probably be investigated or something, right? But no, I just keep pushing forward to this television studio and I just want to make copies. Hey everyone, can we stop fighting so that I can make copies?
Stay frosty.
I will stay frosty, thank you. We get to the television studio only to discover we were tricked. However, this abandoned studio is producing more interesting content than The Big Bang Theory. Then we're on to another mission where I have to destroy some tanks. So first I have to find the weapon to destroy the tanks, which I have trouble finding. Then I have to find a vantage point to destroy the tanks, which I have trouble finding. And then I have to destroy the tanks, which I have trouble doing. And finally, I think the game just destroyed the tanks for me. I'm so good at this. We get some air support to help with the mission. Woo!
Hoorah!
Hoorah indeed. So let's check in with Soap, who...
Incoming missile!
So I'm dead now? But nope, I somehow survived and now I have to- Hey, wait up! We have to sneak through enemy territory to get to the rendezvous point and- Wait, what happened? Is the level over? Oh no, my dog just accidentally unplugged the PlayStation. Way to go, buddy. Ugh, they never have my favorite brands.
Vanya!
I mean, Vanya's good, but if we're talking Chekhov plays, I'm more of a Cherry Orchard guy myself. And then we get another change in perspective as we're manning the guns of a- Hold on. An AC-130. And wait, these levels are chronologically out of order? Look at Tarantino over here. And this mission is... unsettling. You're basically just using your overwhelming arsenal to rain down fire from above, and... Yeah, this left a bad taste in my mouth.
Kaboom.
Kaboom, kaboom, kaboom!
So now we're back to Marine Paul Jackson.
We're not missing this party.
And we'll cry if we want to. So then we get briefed on all the features of a tank, but let's be honest, that's just the floor model, it always looks better than what you drive away with. And now we get an escort mission. Great, everyone loves those.
Contact!
Oh, that's a great movie.
They should have said... the poet.
Two Jodie Foster references in one video? You're welcome. And I'm just over here manning my humble store. I catch up with my team and, What are we doing, guys? We have to destroy an enemy tank, but someone else does that for me since I've proven I clearly can't be trusted with stuff like that. So now I'm firing from a helicopter, and now friendly fire will not be tolerated? And who's shooting at me? That's rude. We step off the helicopter and me first, I went back on first. Then we have to land again to rescue... a woman. The first woman in this game, in fact. Is it weird that there have been no women soldiers in this game? Oh. Guess not. Anyway, we're back in the air and... Oh, here it is. That super surprising moment. That they spoiled in the opening cinematic. And while I've seen this bit on a lot of YouTube listicles, I never saw what happens next. I slowly climb my way out of the helicopter, look around at the destruction, check out the mushroom cloud, and then I... Wow, that's harrowing. Even though we know literally nothing about Sergeant Paul Jackson, it's still a very somber and haunting moment. And now, back to Soap. We're trying to find the terrorist leader's hideout, but I just want to watch TV. Well, if I can't watch TV, no one gets to watch TV. This highly trained soldier has a difficult time hopping a fence, and then... Is someone gonna answer that?
Sir, is his cell phone?
Is your refrigerator running? Then you better catch it.
I told you never to give your number to the Jerky Boys! Yes, the game dispatches its antagonist halfway through its narrative. And then the Tarantino story structure continues with a flashback to Chernobyl 15 years earlier, where our Guy Ritchie character of the captain was, as he puts it,
I was just a lieutenant back then.
They spelled out lieutenant. This game thought it was super important to tell you it's pronounced lieutenant. And I don't know, I just feel like we look ridiculous. Do we look ridiculous? We spend the level sniping some dudes and waiting for other dudes to pass. Don't sneeze. Then we sneak under some trucks and, that's quite a view I have here. I take down this Russian terrorist on my first try somehow, and then my commanding officer gets injured, and so I have to carry him. And then we escape to this actually very real location where we have to survive waves and waves and waves of enemies. After several failed attempts, I find it's easier to just hide in the grass until the rescue chopper arrives. That is, until I get killed by a grenade right at the end there. But I finally escape, we're back in the present day, and I'm using a minigun, which is a rather confusing name for a rather large gun. Then I'm supposed to go to the tavern to detonate some explosives. Where's the tavern? Is this the tavern? Can I get a bourbon, please? And then the sass and Marine start working on a collab.
And the little punk will know how to find Zakea.
The sins of our fathers.
Ain't it a bitch?
That's definitely how people talk. Yes, it turns out the Russian terrorist I shot 15 years ago is still alive. And the best way to get to him is through his son, who's also a terrorist. It's nice he's keeping the family business alive and that he didn't decide to be, like, a figure skater or something. So we take down some Russian troops so we can disguise ourselves.
We don't have much time, so get to it.
I don't know, 2 hours is a lot of time. You could watch Nomadland in that amount of time. We chase down the terrorist's son, corner him on this rooftop, and...
Rupert!
I mean, technically I didn't not get him. So the terrorist is now a bit upset, which, you know, I get. And he threatens to retaliate by nuking the United States, which honestly seems a bit much. So we try to track him down, I become a full-on coward, and yeah, that doesn't look good. They're nuking Philly? Where am I gonna get my water ice now? We get a solid Dr. Strangelove reference, go into the control room, and I'm supposed to enter abort codes, but for the life of me, I can't figure out where in this room I'm supposed to enter the codes. Not there. Or there. Where am I supposed to put these damn- Oh, there it is. So I stop nuclear war, we have a weird chat about beer, and then it's time to take care of this terrorist once and for all. And no, not that guy.
The one? The two?
So I stopped 2 nuclear missiles and took down a notorious terrorist? Nobel Peace Prize, please! And that's it? Yep, the credits roll as we watch more of that super uncomfortable mission. And then we get a special Call of Duty themed rap.
This the third installment, Infinity War shit. Don't soul your jaws, cause it's deep in his heart, bitch.
All in rings.
Eat your heart out, Will Smith. And then we have this random mission where we're on an airplane. For some reason. And we save someone. For some reason. And we jump out of the plane. For some reason. And the plane blows up. For some reason. It doesn't seem to have anything to do with anything else in the game, except for, you know, bang bang pew pew kaboom. So I've played through the single player campaign, which means I've unlocked noir mode.
I knew I had hold of a red hot poker and the time to drop it was before it burned my hand off.
And that's Call of Duty Modern Warfare. Oh, wait, no, there's a whole other multiplayer mode that was incredibly popular back in the day. So I'll check it out. Not that I imagine anyone is still... There are people still playing Call of Duty 4 multiplayer on the PlayStation 3 in 2021. Now I'm very curious. I enter a deathmatch and actually get a few kills. And a promotion. But my team super lost, no doubt thanks to my help. Maybe this one-on-one cage match will be more my style. Or maybe not. So I try the free-for-all mode, playing against people with names like Trump, and MAGA L Douchebag, and Homo Erectus. Lovely. I'm a level 2 up against a bunch of level 55, so... And that was just in the first 3 minutes. But I get another promotion! While being in last place! And while I could spend more time trying to get better at a 14-year-old game populated by a bunch of MAGA folks, you know what? I think I'm good. Having played a few other Call of Duty games, I was surprised by this one. The franchise has often felt soulless and cookie-cutter to me. And not like the fun cookie-cutters that make Christmas trees, just like, you know, a circle. But Modern Warfare seems to have some real passion behind it. The visuals are amazing for the era, with tons of details and some really nice touches, such as seeing eye veins when you're close to death or the way your gun blurs when you're laying on the ground. It really wants to feel epic, and it fully succeeds. Starting from that first mission where you're escaping a sinking ship, to that nuclear explosion, to the car chase near the end, all of it accompanied by a rousing orchestral score, it's very grand in a way few games were back then, and ended up becoming a trademark of the franchise. And while the combat was difficult at times, it also felt merciful, with numerous save points and an AI that helps you out when needed. It's well-paced, alternating between fast, frenetic action and slow, tense nail-biters, and its sound design, music, and voice acting are really quite good. I have to say, it's hard to find fault with the game's design, and if it wasn't for the story, I would be over the moon about this one. But unfortunately... technically, there's pretty much nothing wrong with the game, but playing through it, I felt equal parts confused and uncomfortable. In terms of the actual narrative, it bounced around so much, switching time periods and protagonists with so little warning, that it became hard to keep up at times. And what I could follow left me with a deep discomfort. It wants the plot of the game to resemble real-world conflicts while at the same time wanting to feel like an action movie, which means that more often than not, it straddles an awkward line between realism and ridiculousness. It's particularly unsettling when the game is encouraging you to push forward, and if you don't, you're just sitting there mowing down countless enemies, which in this case are either Russians or Middle Easterners. Given the political climate that we were in at the time, and that we're still in now, it just really doesn't sit well. I know I'm meant to ignore the fact that the Call of Duty franchise has worked with the US military as a recruitment tool, and that they pay a lot of money to gun manufacturers in order to obtain licenses to feature different guns in the game, and just overlook any xenophobia and harmful portrayals in lieu of its Western exceptionalism, but it's hard for me to shake off. It's one thing to be blowing away cacodemons in hell with a plasma rifle, and even later entries in the series give us space battles and drone swarms that hit a little further from home. But this is something else entirely. If video games are meant to embody a fantasy scenario, and this is that scenario, that's not great. So... Call of Duty 4 Modern Warfare is an anomaly on this series. An exceptionally well-designed game that I just couldn't fully enjoy. I admired the hell out of its craft, but narratively, aesthetically, it's just so far removed from anything that I like. I understand its appeal with players, I get the acclaim from critics, but ultimately, it's just not the game for me. And with that, the PlayStation miniseries comes to a close. So time to roll back the clock to another retro game. How far back are we going? Oh. Way far back. Great. Do you know what all these people on your screen have in common? They're all Patreon supporters. And you know what Brianne Shaw and Haley's mom have in common? They're in the tier where I give them shoutouts and videos. If you want to hear your name out of my mouth, go to Patreon and sign up. You can also follow me on Twitter for further updates. Or if you hate any website that isn't YouTube, you can like this video and subscribe and hit the notification bell to find out about future episodes. And you can even suggest games that you want to see me play. My next episode looks at one of the NES's most iconic games, as well as one of its most iconic soundtracks. So until next time, thank you so much for watching.